of the Ben Chamber.
Hello, there you go. Welcome everybody to the third annual Women of the Year event. We're so excited to have you all here tonight. I hope you are ready to be inspired. We are so proud to be hosting this again at the Ben Chamber, and this will be my first year. For those of you who don't know me, it's my first year here at the Chamber and in Bend, and I'm honored to be up here in front of you this evening. I want to thank our sponsors of this evening's event, beginning with our platinum sponsor for the second year in a row, U.S. Bank. We'd also like to thank our gold sponsors, The Bulletin, Bloomwell, and Ferguson Wellham Capital Management. Silver sponsors, Atlas Cider, yum, and Ameritype. And another sponsor of sorts that I want to mention tonight. We have two scholarship donors tonight I wanted to recognize, Express Employment Professionals and Robertson Lincoln Ford in Moscow. We'll be hearing more about that a little bit later. Tonight we celebrate some extraordinary women and young women in our community and revel in their achievements. They each accomplished their goals in different ways, but all of them needed the opportunity and the support network to succeed. And that's where we all come in, and that's why we're here tonight. As you're being inspired, think about what you can do to support women who are working toward achieving something of consequence and meaning. Central Oregon is rich with opportunities for women and girls to create, serve, and succeed. And they have tremendous impact on business. But it takes commitment to continue to provide opportunities for women and support their pursuits. The Women's Lib generation set important groundwork. Baby boomers allowed the Gen Xers and the millennials and beyond to understand what support looks like rather than having to invent it. We've learned how to accomplish great things when we spend our energy building each other up, and we know how to compete with one another by pushing the finish line farther rather than throwing obstacles on the course. There are many ways to be mindful of supporting women in the workplace. I found some recommendations from the Bentley University Center for Women's Studies, and they are useful guidelines. They ask whether your business views women as a strategic asset worth targeting for recruitment. They emphasize the importance of having significant representation of women in leadership in your company, and recommend collaboration in the workplace as a useful tool to include women in business decisions. They also talk about the importance of flexibility to accommodate family life for everybody, and of course, parity of pay. This is not a woman-only initiative. Men are essential to a supportive network for women. I know firsthand my husband, Dom, is not only my supporter, but a true enthusiast of advancing and celebrating women. He and I are a team in talking with our daughter, Abby, and son, Leo, about women and minorities and what equality and compassion looks like in daily life. A man named Jeffrey Tobias Halter is an author and president of Why Women, a consulting company that works with businesses all over the country on advancing women in the workplace. He founded an initiative for fathers to be active champions of creating a world for their daughters that is equitable and full of opportunity. He has a great pledge to that end for fathers on his website. You can Google it at Father of a Daughter Initiative. It's a great read. It's a very personal way to support women, starting with your own family. There's one last point about supporting women that I want to make. It was sparked when I participated in the Women's March a couple of months ago, and the lesson I learned was compassion creates space for diversity. I get nervous in big crowds. They can get unruly pretty quickly. But as the march went on, I was swept up in the capacity of this huge group of people to be compassionate and care about one another. A woman in a wheelchair next to me was separated from her friend, and a group immediately surrounded her and helped her until she was reunited. There were all sorts of kids in the crowd, and we all watched out for them. We ensured they were protected, they were safe, and that they understood what was going on around them. If you set politics and vitriol aside, the compassion I experienced was a reminder of the power of diversity, acceptance, and support. And it's support that brings us here this evening as we celebrate these women who inspire us, who are leaders, doers, and the architects of our community. With that, I'd like to move on and introduce Wendy McGrain. She's representing U.S. Bank this evening as the title sponsor of the Women of the Year Awards, again, for the second time in a row. Wendy is a commercial banking team leader and vice president at U.S. Bank and has lived here since 2005. In addition to her role of managing a team of commercial bankers located throughout Central and Eastern Oregon, Wendy serves on the Bend Economic Development Advisory Board and the Oregon Business Development Corporation. She's also the proud mother of two boys, Hunter and Henry, and her husband, Ben. In her spare time, Wendy has competed and placed in the top three of her age group in two half Ironman Iron Person for this evening, triathlons. Wendy's not new to supporting women in the workplace. Her first job was as an ocean lifeguard in Huntington Beach, California, where women only made up 5% of the workforce. So please help me welcome Wendy to the stage.
Hi there. There's a lot of people out there tonight. Thank you all for coming. I'd like to see a raise of hands for those who are here at this event for the first time tonight. Many of you. Raise your hands if you're here to support a specific nominee tonight. Equally, many of you. I'd also like to see the raise of hands of those of you who nominated someone for an award tonight. Many of you, hopefully most of you who nominated someone are here. Raise your hands if you are not female. Nice showing. A number of men here, men are here to represent the entirety of our community's desire to recognize women. In fact, 14 of the 38 nominations were submitted by men this year. So thank you for that. Why is this event important to U.S. Bank? At U.S. Bank, one of our five core values is that we draw strength from diversity. We have an entire department dedicated to diversity and inclusion. We know that companies in the top quartile for gender diversity are 15% more likely to have financial returns above their respective industry medians. 61% of U.S. Bank's employees are women, which is best in class for gender diversity among our peers. U.S. Bank also maintains a best-in-class status with supplier diversity by doing business with 227 certified women-owned businesses and spending nearly $133 million with certified women-owned enterprises in 2016. We are also an active national corporate member of the Women's Business Enterprise Council. We have 13 women's business resource groups within our company, with another chapter slated to launch later this year. U.S. Bank partners with Working Mother Media and Diversity Best Practices for women's development opportunities throughout the year, and we work closely with the Women's Leadership Institute. For those of you not familiar with U.S. Bank here in Central Oregon, our region is headquartered in Bend. 65% of the management roles in our region are held by women. 40% of our local advisory board are women. Advisory board Julie Harrelson is a nominee tonight. Good luck, Julie. We have a local grant committee, which awarded $133,000 to nonprofits in our region in 2016. Our team of experienced and capable bankers, many of which are here in the audience tonight, welcome the opportunity to provide you with retail, business, and private banking solutions. Please come find us. We're happy to help. Why is this event important to me? Seeing all of you here tonight and learning about all of the extraordinary nominees has shown me that we are a community that values the contributions of women. When our community is inclusive and values all of its members, we are all better for it. This event is one way to do that, and I encourage you all to consider what other ways we can build upon it. Let's be inclusive and strike to break more barriers here in Central Oregon. We have many women leaders here that have already done so, but it's not just about the female leaders, bringing up the new female leaders. It's about our whole community into the conversation. It's about bringing our whole community into the conversation. That's why this event isn't just about women supporting women. It's about our community supporting women. As a woman, I know that I couldn't have achieved what I have and do what I do without the women and men that have supported and sponsored me both personally and professionally. Next year, I would love to see a new awards category with many nominees vying for the award of Top Advocate for the Advancement of Women, open to all genders. That would be awesome. I will leave you with a quote from author Rebecca Solnit from her new book, The Mother of All Questions. The task of calling things by their true names, of telling the truth to the best of our abilities, of knowing how we got here, of listening particularly to those that have been silenced in the past, of seeing how the myriad of stories fit together and break apart, of using any privilege we may have been handed to undo privilege or expand its scope is each of our tasks. It's how we make the world. Thank you. Next, I have the pleasure of presenting our co-MCs for tonight's Women of the Year Awards. To begin, I would like to introduce Meg. It all began at a radio station in Olympia, Washington. It was being an intern at Mix 96.1 that sparked her passion for broadcasting and the opportunity to be a positive voice in the community. She's graduated from San Francisco State University with a degree in broadcast electronic communication arts, and ever since then, she's volunteered, interned, and worked in many aspects of broadcasting. Perhaps you've seen her hosting events in Central Oregon for Hospice of Redmond, the Miss High Desert Pageant, or Pray for Snow at Sun Mountain Fun Center. Meg is thrilled to be living in Bend, laughing with Lonnie in the morning, and hosting her own afternoon show on 177 The Beat. We're going to co-introduce Tammy at the same time. Tammy was our MC last year. Commissioner Tammy Bainey took office in 2007, and has spent the past 10 years serving the residents of Deschutes County. Raised in Bend, she has strong roots in Central Oregon. Tammy has an extensive background in public service and community advocacy. At the state level, she served on leadership teams that have created and implemented policies for early childhood learning and healthcare reform. In 2012, the Oregon Business Association recognized her work in healthcare reform, naming her an Oregon State's Woman of the Year. It's really statesman, but I have to add the woman. She currently serves in governor-appointed roles as chair of the Oregon Transportation Commission and as a member of the Oregon Stability Council. A tireless advocate for Central Oregonians, Tammy serves as chair of the Deschutes County Public Safety Coordinating Council and the Central Oregon Health Council. She has volunteered with a variety of community organizations, including CASA, Habitat for Humanity, the Kids Center, Healthy Beginnings, and the Family Access Network. Tammy enjoys spending time with her daughter, Addie, and her grown foster daughters, Lindsay, Ashley, and Alicia. When she's not in the office, you can find her enjoying all that Central Oregon has to offer. Ladies and gentlemen, Tammy and Meg.
Thank you so much for being here. What an incredible room of inspirational women that we're going to highlight tonight. And I am just so thrilled to be a part of it.
Yes.
Tammy today called me and she told me this incredible story, and I want to make sure that she has an opportunity to share it with you as well.
So one of the great things about emceeing this event is I think about the inspiration that I have in my own life. And I had a young woman who I'm going to just call Hope. She called me. And she wanted to talk about leadership, and I thought, oh, okay, she wants to just hear about when did you get elected and why. And after we spoke for a little bit, she did. She wanted to know a little bit about local government. And then she said, but most importantly, she's 25, and full-time student, works, and she said, I have a son who is 5 years old, and right now he's had 18 brain surgeries. He actually was not expected to live when he was born. And by the end of the summer, it'll be 23. And she said, I want to know from you, how do I have my voice heard? How do I get heard advocating for other parents that have children with special needs? And I just looked at her and I thought, oh my gosh, you are Hope, sitting in my office, offering an opportunity for all of us to feel so blessed about all the chances that we have to affect the lives of others in our community.
Right. No kidding. Great story, right? Well, before we move on, I think we should present our first...
Yes, shall we? No, we're not going to mess up any of the awards tonight, are we? Because I heard on the Oscars there was a...
Well, Tammy, I think that's a good point. You know, we can't really keep that ball rolling.
Okay.
I think we've cut it off.
I mean, they have us, and many know me, and that might happen.
It's
so
true.
Let's hope not.
But let's hope not.
Okay, great.
Also, after this, we should take off these robes.
I'm a little hot, too.
Yeah, this is ridiculous.
Yeah. Well,
also, thanks to the Bend Athletic Club, boxing classes.
Very good.
Yeah.
So, let's go ahead with Rose Miller and Uhane, Hawaii. And Rose Miller was the 2016 Woman of Inspiration. And so she has dedicated herself to making sure that her family's culture and the inspiration of her upbringing is committed in her. She's been dancing since she was 5 years old.
Right.
And so she'll be here this evening dancing for us. So we're thrilled to introduce Rose Miller and Uhane, Hawaii.
Mahalo ni ake ani ni pahi me, poli ni kala ni o kapahi ko. Kapi ni kumbe, ke hanume nube nampai ho koro wa hani ke nube. E nana na maka nage hau mala nungu, yai habai ake ani kawai. Oh,
Thank you.
That was incredible.
I'm still shocked.
Well, okay, the little boy that was laying down, that I feel like that some days. I don't know anybody else, but I felt a little bit like that. And then with everything rolling around my head, it kind of felt like a day in the office.
Like a Monday?
It did. And they had a dance-off, of which, I mean, I don't want to make you look bad, but if you wanted to,
I know
you know.
You could say that. I know it.
Well, what I think is, it was incredibly beautiful, but what I think is really most important is that in the United States, we have an opportunity to celebrate culture, we have an opportunity to celebrate heritage, and how wonderful to have Uhane and to have Rose Miller here tonight. So another round of applause. So now we get on to the awards. We have the Young Hero Award, and helping present the 2017 Young Hero Award, Northwest poet and writer and author of Everywhere Oracle, A Guided Journey Through Poetry for an Ensouled World, and 2017 Woman of the Year Judge, Carol Ann Casbon. And joining her, fellow Woman of the Year Judge and the Ben Chambers 2005 Sage Citizen of the Year Award recipient, and if she is in your life, you are incredibly blessed, Connie Drewliner, owner of Express Employment Professionals. It is also my pleasure to introduce Tamara Weber, Human Resource Manager at Robertson Ford, and Stephanie Miller, Connie's business partner and co-owner at Express Employment Professionals. So, please help us in welcoming these amazing ladies.
So how did you like those hula girls? At this moment and say they're all wonderful. Two of them were my grandchildren, Stephanie's children, and we hope that they get an award someday. So let me just take a moment and say thank you for the opportunity to honor this year's nominees for Women of the Year. I also want to recognize our past recipients that are here in the room, and we saw a lot of them. And of course, I cannot leave out all of you in attendance this evening. Tonight's awards recognize the women in our community who take risks, who overcome challenges. They use their intelligence, their innovation, to build businesses and create community programs that will address the needs of others. Wise women they are. At the heart of Women of the Year, we're here to support all ages and stages of life. Each one of these women is worthy and serves as a role model of faith, caring, and servant leadership. And you've heard me for 3 years on stage say this is my favorite day of the year. So I also would like to recognize and have her come out this evening, Robin. She is our founder and our leader.
Is she coming?
She is, slowly. Right.
Robin, get up.
She's being shy.
You're being summoned.
She shall by any means. But I really want you to know that this lady, who is our founder and our leader, truly lives the saying, everything is possible. She's made our Women of the Year Awards a signature event with a full house every year, evidenced by tonight. Robin is making a difference in supporting the advancement of women. Through her significant accomplishments, Women of the Year is on the map, and it's for the betterment of all. Robin.
Thank you, Connie. She's very kind, and I have to tell you, I am not in this endeavor alone. I have all these women on stage with me, and all of the women that I work with, I couldn't do it without them. I've been blessed to be surrounded by strong women throughout my life. I stand on the stage, as I said, with some of those women, and the others, my Ben Chamber team, are amongst us. They're behind stage. They helped you at the front door. And as I mentioned, I could not do it without them. I also have had the fortune to raise two amazing children who inspire me each and every day. My son Ryan, a father himself, makes me laugh each day, and I am so proud of his persistence and fun for life and adventure. And my beautiful daughter, and she is one of my heroes, I call her Annie Dawn, but her squadron, the Bold Tigers, call her Vader. Thank you. Yes, let's hear it. Now, 38 years later, I'm blessed once again with the opportunity to raise my 16-year-old niece, Maya, who is here this evening with Mountain View High School Culinary Arts Program, serving us food this evening. I also just recently have the pleasure of raising my stepdaughter, Bella, who pushes me to rise above the occasions and stay the course, being the role model that I hope one day will help her find her passion in life. Having raised a successful daughter and now raising two young girls, I know and feel the struggles, and I know the forces and dedication it takes to stay the path towards our personal excellence. So to all of our young heroes tonight, my message to you is never, ever, ever stray from your dreams or your passions. Keep your sight on your dreams. My daughter's dream at 10 years old was to fly jets. Some smiled and nodded, but really, really, really didn't take her seriously. But I did. And today, our Annie Dawn, alias Vader, calls the cockpit of the F-15 her office.
Yeah!
So, to all you young heroes out there, I say to you, don't be afraid to reach for the stars. Grab it with both hands and follow your path and follow your dreams. You can do anything you set your mind to.
So when Robertson Ford was approached with the opportunity of being part of this Young Hero Scholarship and Award, Jeff Robertson was absolutely thrilled. His family has had a tradition of valuing education and supporting it in our community. And this award falls right in line with those values. It supports the efforts of these young heroes as they're going to go forward to improve and change our community and our lives. So I'm honored to be presenting tonight this award to one of these truly inspiring young women.
Express is very honored to partnership with Robertson Ford on this scholarship for the Women of the Year. We have really always dedicated ourselves to education and the belief that as we put forth the effort to our younger generation, that we will really help our community and those people that we care about most succeed. All of the nominees today are phenomenal students, and each one of them really have three outstanding characteristics. They have academic achievement, citizenship, and leadership. While only one can win today, we are lucky to have all of them in our midst. Thank you.
Well, this is my first time serving as a judge, and so for this program, and Robin asked me to say a few things about what the program meant to me and what being a judge for it meant to me. And I thought of the quote by the wonderful Sufi mystic and poet Rumi, who said, "Let the beauty you love be what you do. There are a thousand ways to kneel and kiss the ground." And I have to say, reading through all of the nominees' materials and getting a glimpse into their lives, I felt like I was having a glimpse into the hundreds of ways women in this community are making a difference. I was at the vet the other day, and we were talking about arthritis, and she said, "Well, what sports programs were you in school?" And I said, "Well, I wasn't. They didn't have sports for women when I went through school." And that the women's movement came along right after. And I just realized the connection between that conversation and this evening. And it's such a joy to be a part of this program that is celebrating women in our community and supporting women, and it's just quite an honor to be a small part of this. I want to just let you know what this first award is about and who it's for. We're in the Young Heroes Award. We are recognizing young women 14 to 17, and we're celebrating their accomplishments through their efforts in volunteering in this community and through their passion and their determination to make a difference. And they have identified things that the community needs, and they've gone out on a limb and they've made a difference through their efforts by doing something. And so it's really exciting. It gives me so much hope for our future to have been witness to all of these young women.
So we were so excited about the scholarship, and Robin said, would you contribute this time? And I said, I'm in. And when we talked to Jeff, he said, I'm in too. And I want you to know that you can be in with us, because we are going to continue to grow this scholarship much bigger than it is today. And Jeff and I are on the advisory board, and we would welcome anybody else in. Today I have been able to drive one of his brand new cars. If you contribute, I'll see what I can do. So, on with the show. The winner of the 2017 Young Hero Award is a true leader in her school and in our community. Her teachers and counselors say she's hardworking, she's intellectual, and she's curious. She enjoys challenging herself and feeling the accomplishment that comes with that hard work. Our 2017 Young Hero works hard in the classroom by taking challenging AP courses, which will earn her top honors and her diploma in June this year. A senior at Summit High School, she's an accomplished musicianist. Our Young Hero earned an internship at Bend Research. In our community, she's a leader co-founding Bend Chapter of Youth Climate Action Now, which was very pivotal in getting Ben to pass a climate action resolution. If I say that the judges were impressed, and you heard Carol say we were, this young woman is amazing. She has worked 14 months with leaders of the local environmental organizations, had meetings with the city councilors and the staff, had interviews with the newspaper and the TV stations. She's wrote letters and documents to support all the resolutions. She spoke on the panels at city council meetings to take this important climate to action. And the changes are coming down the road. So before we have her come up on stage, I would love to have Tamara read all the recipients.
So the nominees for the Young Heroes are Olivia Courtier, Skylar Grayson, Mackenzie Napier, and Carly Moore.
And the 2017 recipient of the Young Hero Award is Skylar Grayson. $1,000 scholarship. Congratulations. Congratulations to all the winners.
I'm very not prepared for this, but thank you so much. It's an honor, and an honor to be considered among all the amazing women that are here tonight. I don't know what to say. Thank you.
Congratulations. How exciting. Another award is soon to be received, you know, all night long. We've got plenty.
A bit of hope in our community. It's nice to see the next generation really getting engaged.
No kidding. Well, without further ado, we will move right along, presenting the award for Community Hero. Please welcome our 2015 Community Hero, Betsy Warner, and Sarah Lauderdale from Men Radio Group, and Women of the Year Judge, Bonnie Vandiver, Events Coordinator at the Ben Chamber.
This award acknowledges women who are making outstanding contributions to their community, to our community. Community heroes demonstrate how people with passion and determination can use their lives to make a difference in the world and our community.
When I received the Community Hero Award in 2015, I remember how thrilled my daughters were. And it was truly special to have this acknowledgement for the work that I love doing in engaging volunteers in our community. And this year, we have several nominees for the Community Hero Award, and we ask you each to stand when your name is said, please. And the nominees for Community Hero are...
Mary Anderson.
Mrs. Honnold to say her name. Patty Devincenzi. Whitney Eskelson.
Jamie Kansky.
Kristen Lingman. Catherine Noyed.
Melissa Parker.
Allison Perry. Morgan Schmidt.
Good evening. I'm Bonnie. I'm the events coordinator at the Ben Chamber. It is my honor to present this year's nominee in the Community Hero Award category. I am here on behalf of our 2016 Community Award Hero. I'm sorry, Community Award winner, the amazing Kim Meter, who is unable to attend this evening and asked me to present in her place. With that, I would like to read her words of encouragement to this year's recipient. It was with profound gratitude that I help announce the next Woman of the Year Community Hero Award. Although I don't know her name or face, I do know her. She is a woman with strong and passionate heart. Her life's desire is to serve others, giving out the same generosity that has been poured into her own life. She is selfish and kind, selfless. Wow. Selfless and kind, gentle and trusting, and a fierce advocate for the hope that's been entrusted to her. I know this woman because I am this woman. Although her heart doesn't seek recognition, when genuine appreciation comes, it is welcomed like a warm rain. For those who serve this great community with gentleness of a lamb and the heart of a lion, to be recognized by the same fuels the heart for greater service. So for the next community hero of Bend, get ready for the warm rain to shower. Trust me, it's going to feel like standing under Chehalis Falls. Thank you, friend, for all you do. Your work is appreciated by this community more than you know. Never stop giving up on your unique and powerful way. It is a gift this nation needs more of. Indeed, our world needs more selfless women with hearts such as yours. For the journey ahead, may God continue to fill you with his abundant love, strength, hope, and joy. Thank you, Kim Meter. And the nominees are, and if you stand please, Mary Anderson,
is definitely anything but selfish. This community hero took on a vision to help veterans suffering from post-traumatic stress disorder. A ranch that could support itself and be a place of healing for all veterans. She had little to no money in the bank, and yet she was able to somehow pull it all together. The ranch is an ongoing uphill battle. Many people would give up, but not her. This year, she was able to get the ranch licensed to receive adult foster care for veterans. She is now, and always will be, a hero to all of Central Oregon vets. The 2017 community hero is
Alison Perry.
Something greater than themselves. The call is undeniable, and to follow it sometimes seems reckless, even dangerous, and does not always make sense to others. I've never met a veteran who considered himself or herself a hero, and nor do I. Those of us who travel this path have learned that the reward of being a hero is serving a mission greater than ourselves. I thank you for recognizing that I chose to travel this path, and in honor of the veterans that I serve and that we serve at the ranch and the 20,000 veterans that live in Central Oregon, I humbly accept this award. Thank you. If anyone has stood up a nonprofit, it is not easy, and the grit that woman has, oh my goodness, incredible. Congratulations. So, speaking of inspiration and incredible women,
like to, our keynote speaker this evening is Sarah Poole. And if we could just bottle up, I mean, just little bitty bottles even of her energy.
Right.
Oh my gosh.
It would never be a Monday.
Oh my gosh, ever. Right.
Yeah.
So she is the CEO of Besso and the founder and past CEO of Pacific Superfood Snacks. Okay, the kale chips. I didn't like kale chips and I tried them. They're really,
really
yes. Okay. Which later became part of Made in Nature family of brands.
Right, and Sarah earned numerous awards while leading Pacific Superfood Snacks, including the Ben Chamber Women of the Year Entrepreneur of the Year Award, Top Women Run B Corporations, and the Thai Pitch Fest Entrepreneur Award. I've already talked to Sarah about how many times I have to say entrepreneur up here, and I am trying my best not to stumble over it. We continue. She has spoken at TEDx and other conferences and events such as the OEN Entrepreneurial Summit, Foxwork, and the National Honor Society. Prior to founding Pacific Superfood Snacks, Sarah was the director of finance of a global nonprofit based in Portland and a private wealth management advisor at Merrill Lynch.
Not surprising, she earned a full-ride basketball scholarship to the University of California, Berkeley, where she was named captain, imagine that, most inspirational player. I mean, that's just surprising, isn't it?
That's wonderful.
It is, right, exactly. She earned her MA and her BA at Berkeley, graduating with a 3.9 GPA, and she is a Bend native. So, kudos to that.
I know.
Are you proud or what? So, ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together and welcome to the stage the 2016 Entrepreneur of the Year, the amazing and inspirational Sarah Poole.
Freaking much for your passion and your drive and your commitment and your heart and your love and your vision that you share with us through everything you do. You are our heroes. You are awesome. You get me so fired up. I'm so fired up to be here. Judges, thank you. Bend Chamber of Commerce, thank you. Sponsors, thank you. I can't believe that we're sitting in Bend, Oregon with an absolutely packed house celebrating women entrepreneurs. Yes. I'm so pumped up. Shannon. I love you. Shannon Keith. Hero. Jamie Dammick. Hero. Yes. Okay. So back in 1984, two young Bend people drove up to Portland, Oregon. And they picked my scrawny little butt up at the hospital. And they drove back down to Bend, down to 11th Street to their house where I got to hang out with them. They were two young people who were high school sweethearts from Bend High. My mom was teaching at Buckingham Elementary. My dad was just getting his start in the carpet business down off of South Highway 97, Larry's Carpet Center. The two, I don't know if you got your carpet from them, but it's pretty nice. They couldn't have kids, so they adopted both my sister and I. And it's so crazy how one little event can shape your entire life's perspective. From the time I was young, I realized that of the 4.7 billion people on the planet in 1984, I could have been matched with anyone, anywhere. But I got two young kids from Bend, Oregon, of all places. I feel like the luckiest person in the world. So for me, those odds are like we're talking about one in billions. One in billions odds that I got matched with two people. It's like it's not even odds anymore. It's like this unbelievable miracle and magical. It's just simply a miracle.
So with that, I've taken that into my whole life. And that for me is like rule number one, is that perspective is absolutely everything. The stories that we tell ourselves are absolutely everything. Life is a gift, right? And we could just as easily say, I could be telling the opposite story. Oh, I was abandoned, and they didn't want me. My biological people, they didn't want me, and on and on and on. But it's amazing that we've been gifted with this thing inside of us that allows us to choose whether we open or we close, whether we choose love and acceptance, or we choose to retreat into fear and to doubt, right? So that is rule number one, principle number one is perspective is everything. The stories that we tell ourselves are everything. I feel like the luckiest person in the world right now. So two, when I was young here growing up in Bend, I remember I used to ask my mom to drop me off at Jewel School really early, like an hour early, because I was obsessed with the game of basketball. I wanted to be a professional at it. I could not get enough. I would love to get there early so that I could be the first one who got to pick the teams. I wanted to be the team captain. I wanted to practice my shot over and over and over again. By the time I got to high school, I was in the gym 7 days a week. I was in the gym on the weekends. I was in the gym on the summers. By the time I was a senior in high school, I had earned a full ride basketball scholarship to the University of California, Berkeley, to Cal. Go Bears. I remember, yes. Go Bears.
Go Bears.
Yeah, baby, go Bears. I remember when I was in college, I remember this bright red flashing alarm, 3:45 a.m., 3:45 a.m., 3:45 a.m., 3:45 a.m., where I would jump up out of bed, already clothed in my practice jersey, and I would go and I would pick up my teammate across town, and we would get to the gym. We would have to break into the gym pretty much 90% of the time so that we could be on the court at 4:30, which was an hour and a half before we were supposed to start practice. Again, it was an obsession. I wanted to be the best. We wanted to be the best. We wanted to be great. We wanted to get the reps in. We wanted to be prepared. We wanted to be ready. As I went through Cal, I didn't take one summer off. I trained all summer long. I went to school all summer long. I double majored. I almost triple majored. By the time that I had graduated, I had 38 units over what the university allows. Before they're like, get out, you've been here, you must be a like 20-year lifelong student, right? So I had pushed myself really, really hard. I got admitted into graduate school at Berkeley. I finished a master's degree program. I went on and applied to another master's degree at Berkeley, and I started teaching high school English at Oakland High School, one of the most poorest high schools in the country. I also taught classes at Cal as an undergraduate courses, and I got my entire education paid for. I decided that I wanted to go make some money to see if I could actually do that, so I moved all the way across the country in 2007 to Boston, where I started working at Merrill Lynch. I knew absolutely nothing about finance. I actually majored not in business, but it's like the story of my life. I just want to see if I can do something. It's like the fake it till you make it. So I moved out there in 2007, which, as you know, was really smart time to make money, because in 2008, the financial crisis hit. Merrill Lynch was going down. Bank of America swoops in to save the day. Three-fourths of my team, the cohort that I had come in to Merrill Lynch with, they were let go, and I was kept on. At the age of 25, I became the director of finance of a global organization based in Portland. It was the first time in my life that I had seen that the idea that you can change the world is not just an idea, that change is possible. Shannon Keith. yes, baby, yeah. At the age of 27, I decided I would start a kale chip company in my garage. I grew that company very quickly into a multi-million dollar company. At the age of 30, that company was acquired by one of the leading global natural foods brands based in Boulder, Colorado, called Made in Nature. I still believe that these kale chips are the best on the planet. I'm still in love with them, still obsessed with them. At age 32, where I stand today, I decided to move across the country to New York City to pursue what I feel in my heart is almost an impossible dream. And that dream is we partnered with AB InBev and the World Food Program to address food waste and hunger. 795 million people go to bed hungry. That number is growing every single day. Simultaneously, 31% of the food in our country, on a conservative estimate, goes to waste. We want to make a dent in that problem. We want to make a big dent in that problem and see if change is really possible. But I'll say this. I think I'm great. I don't think I'm special. I've never been the smartest. I've never been the most talented. I definitely am not the most physically capable still to this day. But I do hustle. I'm hungry. I'm determined. I'm passionate about using every single moment of this life and doing something with it. I feel that we built our kale chip business on that one principle. I saw all of our competitors nationally. I saw the big brands, I saw the small brands, and I thought, we can out-hustle them. I've been up at 3:45 a.m. When I was in elementary school, I was the first one there when I didn't have to be. My parents didn't tell me to do that. I know that we can out-hustle our competition. So in the late, late night when it was dark, or the early, early morning when it was really, really dark and nobody was up, I knew my competitors weren't up. I knew they weren't up. And I knew I knew they weren't thinking of me, but I knew I was thinking of them. I had their number. The point of it all is that that it's all about hustle. It's all about hustle. And don't just hustle. Point number two, out-hustle, right? Out-hustle. Out-hustle yourself every single day. Be your best every single day. Number three, I hear people say all the time they have this amazing idea and there's something they're really passionate about, or they want to make a career change, or something that's really digging at their heart. But I don't know why, but immediately when they go out to go after that, maybe they face a few no's and get rejected, or maybe their family tells them they're crazy, or maybe they compare themselves to someone who they think is successful and they don't think that they're as talented as them, they don't have the it factor, and they give up too early, too soon. The reality is that every single person, no matter how successful you are, no matter how great you are, still struggles, still has those dark moments, still has that doubt, still gets rejected, right? And so the point of that is that, I'm going to stop for a second. I have a really important point to say. I don't want to leave it out. I've been traveling nonstop for the past month. I've been home like 3 days, and it's a little kooky upstairs. But yes, okay, got it. Woo-hoo. Cool. All right. I'm like Donkey Kong. So, starting Grayso, starting this new company has been the most terrifying thing I've ever done. Ever. I've questioned myself more than I ever have in my entire life. Like right when I thought I was confident, oh, you got Women of the Year Award, oh, your company got bought, oh, you sold, like, oh, I'm skateboarding every single night, like, I'm down Jackson's Corner like 20 times a week. You guys have probably seen me there. Like, why are you drinking so much wine? Like, I thought you were a kale chip person. It's like, it's been terrifying. It's been terrifying. Like for the first 2.5 months that I've been in New York City, I wake up every morning like this. Oh my gosh, God. This again. I'm like, Mom, Dad, SOS, send airplane ticket home, have camping bags ready, I'm going to hide out, right? It's really absolutely terrifying. I face my worst self every single day. The person that I thought was so confident and so great, I see that every day. And it really happened recently. I was presenting to the CEO of AB InBev, of Anheuser-Busch, and to 3G Capital, which is the capital group made up of three people that own AB InBev, Kraft Heinz, and et cetera, et cetera. It has a market cap of $350 billion. I'm presenting to these four people and one of my colleagues in the room. And I'm getting ready and I'm starting to prepare my presentation and all day long it was like, what do you think you're doing? Like, you think you can do this? Like, you're gonna forget everything you say. Like, you don't even, do you remember your name? How are you gonna remember your presentation to like people who really matter? And I was really terrified. I went in and I did my preparation. I went into the bathroom. I did my Tony Robbins pump up the jam. I'm like, you've got this. Like you're cool. Like, and the second I walk in, it was unreal, you guys. Like, it was unreal. I walk in. I sit down in the chair. I look across the room. My hands start shaking. My legs start shaking. I think my hair is shaking. My ears are twitching. I don't know. I'm sitting there, and I develop this matrix-like superpower where instantly I see all three exit signs on the entire floor calculating at the same time the distance and the time it will take me to get to the closest exit door. I can run home. I'm good. Like, I'm good. Like, I did the ketchup thing. I'm good, right? So I get up, I present, I have no idea to this day what I said, we got the funding, et cetera, et cetera. But it's like funny because it really doesn't even really matter if we won that or we lost that, because the point of it all is to face those fears, right? Is to push. So point number three is that there is a voice of self-doubt. And then there's a voice of truth. And the truth is that every single person in this room is born for greatness. The truth is that we have to keep going step after step after step after step when we think we've made it, when we think we've failed, when we have failed epically, we have to keep going. The truth is, the promise is that when we seek it, we will find it. The promise is that when we knock, the door is open, right? So we have to listen to the right voice. We have to listen to the right voice. Both are there. Both are competing for space. Listen to the right voice. The fourth and final point, which I think is maybe the most important of them all, is that it is so much better when we do it together. When we take people with us. When we don't do it solo. When we don't try to be the best, but leave the rest behind. Right? In Buddhism, there's this thing called the Bodhisattva's path. Bodhisattva's path, and the point of it is that when you attain enlightenment, when you reach nirvana, instead of staying in this heaven-like place, instead of staying in nirvana and enlightenment, you go back for infinite lifetimes to help other people get there too. And I love that story. In Christianity, Jesus, right? He says, "You are a light unto the world. You don't put a lamp under a bowl and cover it. You put a lamp out on the stand so that it gives light to everyone in the room," right? So we are so much better together. There's so much more joy when we get to do it together. You are somebody's miracle. I am somebody's miracle. We have to go be that miracle to other people. So in summary, number one, right, is I don't really remember right now. Winning this speech, back to the practice squad, back to practice. Number one, perspective is absolutely everything. Protect that story, protect the story that you tell, right, that you tell yourself. Number two, hustle. Don't just hustle, but out-hustle. Number three, there's a voice of self-doubt, and there is a voice of truth. Listen to the voice of truth. Let the voice of truth win. Another number four is take people with you. Thank you guys so much. Women of the Year, thank you so much.
Space of offering you grace. I mean, you go back and you read that because you know what? we're all here together celebrating each other, and I love the fact, so one of my favorite quotes is hustle until your critics ask if you're hiring, and so that's kind of, I mean, when you say hustle, you bet, and that determination, that dedication, I mean, oh my gosh, and the fact that you're from Bend, I mean, you just give, you exude light. Whenever I see you out and about, I'm like, okay, there she is. Oh, biggest smile in town. I mean, and it's welcoming. She's just a smile. She's like a hug waiting to happen. You see her, I ran into her. I was at Market of Choice, and I just walked up and I gave her a hug. And I was like, I hope she remembers who I am. And because, and you know what? You know what? She hugged me because she's a hug waiting to happen. And so I just, you know, inspiration, but you also give that light of there's hope and there's dedication that if you apply yourself, you can do this. And so, yeah, thank you so much for all that you've given.
One thing I would like to say, though, is once upon a time I thought I was doing pretty good in life, and then I met Sarah. thank you for that. It's a nice reality check and a nice, like, kick in the caboose to keep going. You know what I mean? But really, thank you so much for spreading all of that. And you're right, being so authentic to come back and look back. You know, here I have my fancy cards, and trust me, I'm going to look at them in a second. But I can't help but thank you for being so authentic and being so relatable. You know, you can come up here and tell us your whole life story. We're going to live our own life story, but we can reflect on what you've learned and then hopefully come up here and do something just as amazing as you. So thank you so much for being here.
Yeah. Doubted themselves. I loved that piece of what you said, because that little voice in our head saying you're not enough or saying that you can't do it, thank you for being the voice that you can. Yeah, so,
you,
yeah, absolutely. I think you're giving away
To help Sarah present this next award for Entrepreneur of the Year, please welcome to the stage the Bend Chambers 2016 Business Award recipient for Entrepreneurs of the Year. Her name is Samantha McCoy, and she is the owner of Atlas Cider.
All right. Through timely innovation, strategic thinking, and smart execution, the recipients of the Entrepreneur of the Year Award has launched and built one or more successful companies with a track record of growth, profitability, industry leadership, and breaking new ground.
These preeminent entrepreneurs possess the drive, managerial acumen, and leadership traits that others aspire to have and have positioned themselves for the future achievement. These women are role models for all those who believe in the power of entrepreneurship. Winners of this award have generated an uncommon degree of economic growth and social change and must be at least 18 years of age.
And the nominees for Entrepreneur of the Year are Jamie Dannett,
Christine Evert,
Shannon Keith,
Healy Manila,
Dr. Terry Mucha,
Sally Pfeiffer,
Terry Sandusky,
Heather Nichelle Straw,
and Jamie Weeks. A trip to India in 2005 inspired this entrepreneur to take action and begin an innovative business venture. Her drive to disrupt the social enterprise space and create lasting impact for survivors of and those at the highest risk of sex trafficking led her to found and cultivate
a thriving benefit corporation whose mission is rooted in job creation for women in India.
This entrepreneur's company's products support the training and jobs for the women who make them, and also help to fund the nonprofit arm that allows the organization to provide for those same women across their entire ecosystem. More than a give-back model, her organization enables women to have freedom-filled choices for themselves and for their families. And the recipient of the 2017 Entrepreneur of the Year is...
Shannon
speech, and I don't think I've stopped. I was teary all through Sarah's because I'm just... Sorry. I'm overwhelmed with the amazing women in this room, and just to be counted amongst them, I felt like a winner. Like being nominated, I was like, oh my gosh, where did this come from? I was so excited, over the moon. And it really is on behalf of all the women and children that we serve in India that I accept this, because I just feel like there's probably lots of people much more deserving of this than me, but it gives a platform just to recognize powerful women all over the globe who just need opportunity. And so I'm just honored to use my position of privilege to be their voice. And so I accept it on their behalf, and I have an incredible team here in Bend. So I wanna also thank my amazing parents and my loving husband, because for those of us who have partners in our lives, there's no way that you can get through 1 minute of any day without the support of your partner. And my life mate is amazing. We've been married 16 years and have 3 incredible children. And my parents that are watching the kids tonight, I mean, it really does take a village to raise an entrepreneur. I also just really wanna just thank the Chamber for this amazing event that highlights the work of women. I think there's such progress happening in our world, and I am so hopeful for the future. I also just really appreciate the advisors, many of which are in the room, my personal business advisors that have also just poured into me. I'm just like a sponge and I learn every day. I'm overwhelmed by Sarah. I feel like I'm gonna soak in that inspiration like all week long. So thank you, Ben Chamber, thank you everyone. I'm in awe and I'm so humbly grateful. Thank you very much.
I know. No, I had no idea this evening was going to be so emotional.
Right.
But it's wonderful. It's obviously happy tears because this is just, as she said, just an incredible room of women and men. Thank you for being here as well.
One thing that I would like to point out is, how about a hand for the judges? This incredible, amazing women. I mean, having to actually pick a winner, because they're all winners, is just an incredible task. And so thank you to the judges who have made time to do that.
Thank you.
I wanted to take just a brief moment. It's my understanding that Marty Brazil is not well and was going to be with us, but she was also nominated. And so if we could send her a little bit of love as well, could be with us this evening. So thank you very much.
for his lifetime achievement. And to present the Lifetime Achievement Award, please welcome to the stage Ben Chambers, 2015 Sage Business Award recipient of the People's Choice Award, and the winner of our Women of the Year, one of our Women of the Year judges, Stephanie Anderson Stroop, who I saw wandering around a little bit. Yes, come on down. It's like a game show. Come on down. All right. Okay. Also, one of my favorite people, please welcome Pamela Hulse Andrews, owner of Ben Fashion Quarterly Magazine, keeping us all up to date, and a Woman of the Year judge as well. So please welcome those two fine ladies, and we'll get on with the show, Lifetime Achievements. Thank you very much.
Seek to identify the leaders who teach our future leaders by example. The Lifetime Achievement Award winners have shown a long-term active engagement in their community and have made significant impacts in the lives of others. They're successful leaders in our companies, businesses, nonprofit organizations, our schools, the community, and of course within their friends and families. This award allows us to recognize the true pillars within this community. I can tell you that as being a part of this process, it has felt absurd to judge and absolutely impossible to select. But it has been an honor and a humbling experience to be a part of this. I am going to ask our nominees to stand. It is my honor to introduce the nominees for our 2017 Lifetime Achievement Awards. Stephanie Alstad. Lone Hunter. Stevenson, and Clella Thomas.
So I do want to tell you that Lone is in California right now having surgery on a brain tumor and getting stem cell research. So we're wishing her well. She may be awake now and, you know, well, she's probably not listening to it, but, you know, we'll be texting her, so anyway, wish her well. I'm so excited about the Lifetime Achievement Award. I mean, first of all, think about the women who've been nominated. I mean, you know, and they do range in age. I mean, there's some of them are a little bit younger and some of them are a little bit older, but I'm telling you, in their short lifetimes, they have achieved so significantly much for our community. The Lifetime Achievement person for this evening is someone that, if you've only been here a couple years, you probably will have had some experience of working with her. But she's been here for a good 40 years or so, and, you know, starting with her family, and then with education, and sharing community, especially working on education, because she helped champion tax bases and money for schools, and improving our school system, and then moving on to work at to help SMART grow, Tower Theater. I had this incredible experience working with this kind, incredible, funny woman who balanced everything out and made it so achievable and successful. So it's an honor. I mean, it almost makes me want to cry when I think about the person who's going to achieve this award tonight, but she is so deserving, and we are so fortunate to have all of the things that she's given back to our community recently, also working on the OSU campus. And then I remember a couple other things a few years ago about working on the Juniper Ridge situation that wasn't going well, and she kind of helped kind of move that forward. So we're going to give her the award tonight. I know she already knows who it is because, you know, I already mentioned all that, but I'll let Stephanie announce it.
Our 2017 Lifetime Achievement Award winner is Clella Thomas.
Wow. Thank you so much for this award. I'm so honored just to have been nominated with three such outstanding other women. And I can't possibly take credit for all the successes of the endeavors I've embarked on, because truly it's always been a partnership and a group effort. And I just want to thank the many other people who've worked with me over the years, the outstanding leaders, the volunteers, and the generous financial donors. We've worked together to achieve a lot of common goals, and it's been a real pleasure working with you. Honestly, my best friends in this town are people I've worked with on projects, like Pamela. In fact, we worked on restoring this theater, and I had no idea it was gonna be so awful standing up here. Anyway, I also want to thank my wonderful husband of 46 years, Bob. Not only has he put up with me, but he has been very encouraging and given me great advice and always been supportive of everything I've tried to do. I just want to add that in more recent years, I've had the pleasure of working with several younger volunteers and leaders, and I'm so encouraged by that. I'm just really impressed by their ideas, by their skills, and by the energy that they bring to the community. And I'm speaking about a lot of you in this audience when I say this. So I have great hope for the future of Bend, and I know that we all want to continue to work together to make sure that Bend is always a wonderful place to live, to learn, and to work. So thank you so much.
Persuaded me somewhere in this room. I have a chair with a name on it. When we were, I'm not sure many of you as well, received a call and a letter asking, would you please donate? And we're going to restore the Tower Theater. Yes, it was just yesterday, right? Something along that line. But what I love about Clella is you know that when she makes a call or when she sends you a note, you know that it's something that's of importance to the community. And so I've always enjoyed your leadership, and thank you so much for all that you've done and for all of the ladies who have been acknowledged with this particular Lifetime Achievement nomination.
Oh, that's fantastic. Congratulations. And now, award-winning poet and author Ellen Watterson. We've got a little performance coming up next. Ellen is a literary arts advocate and award-winning poet and author. Her fourth volume of poetry, Hotel Domilocos, will be released next month. Her verse novel, Vija Lactea, was converted to an opera and premiered in Bend this time last year. And now it's slated for a second staging in Eugene this year.
Ellen has selected a sampling of poems that she feels would be appropriate for this evening and inspiring for the women that are celebrated this evening as well. So please welcome Ellen.
Okay, everybody, let's hear it for poetry. Good evening. I want to thank all of the organizers of this exciting evening, and congratulations to all of the deserving nominees and winners. I have three poems for you, three. The first, I Wish I Could Claim. It is by Mary Oliver and is a favorite of mine. And I chose it because in this room tonight, filled with so many accomplished women, I thought it worth taking a moment to let Mary Oliver once again remind all of you of what you don't need to do to be a presence in the world and to be a force for good. The title of the poem is Wild Geese. And it, as is the tradition with poetry readings, you can hold your applause until the end of the third poem. Wild geese. You do not have to be good. You do not have to walk on your knees for 100 miles through the desert repenting.
You only have to let the soft animal of your body love what it loves. Tell me about despair, yours, and I will tell you mine. Meanwhile, the world goes on. Meanwhile, the sun and the clear pebbles of rain are moving across the landscapes, over the prairies and deep trees, the mountains and rivers. Meanwhile, the wild geese, high in the clean blue air, are heading home again. Whoever you are, no matter how lonely, the world offers itself to your imagination, calls to you like wild geese, harsh and exciting, over and over again, announcing your place in the family of things. Good job. This next poem I wrote after unsuccessfully taking flying lessons some years ago. Clearly, from my instructor's response, flying a small airplane was not my calling. As it turns out, my experience of flying and this poem is about trying too hard, designed to fly. After 10 hours of trying, the instructor undid my fingers, peeled them one by one off the joystick. You don't need to hold the plane in the air, he advised. It's designed to fly. A hint of aileron, a touch of rudder is all that is required. I looked at him like I'd seen God. Those props and struts he mentioned, they too, I realized, all contrived. I grew dizzy from the elevation, from looking so far down at the surmise. The airspeed of faith underlies everything. Lives are designed to fly. And this final poem I offer to all of you as a celebration and reminder of how unique each of us, how unique each of you is. First, before I read, I want to again thank everyone who put this remarkable evening together and acknowledge all the good works being done by this amazing community and those of you who are moving those projects forward. Make believe you're an envelope with a note inside, written in the form of a prayer. The all of you, your M-dash laugh, your run-on mistakes, is your unique inscription written in an elegant metaphysical hand, then folded, placed inside the envelope that is you, and gently mailed into the world when you are born. Your prayer is written within the within of you. The space between each you word is where heaven abides. Your prayer is a daily reporting, a timeless telling of all the ways you are coming to brightness, to life. Every day, if you can, turn more and more inside out so the one, the only you prayer is exposed to more and more light. Thank you.
I just have to say Not only do I feel fortunate to know Ellen, but I think we're fortunate to have her talent in our community. The depth of her soul, she is an inspiration. But the other piece is that she also, with her writing retreats, helps individuals unlock their own creativity and their own inner story. And to me, that really is inspirational in terms of giving people that courage of putting pen to paper and saying, you have a story, and I can help you tell that.
Right. Right, she's pretty incredible.
She is, so thank you, Ellen. So ladies and gentlemen, now for the award that we've all been waiting for, Woman of the Year. Yes, okay. 2016 Chamber of Commerce Woman of the Year, Mo Carrick, principal and founder of Momentum Incorporated, a certified B Corp, and author of soon-to-be-released book, of which I should read, Fit Matters, How to Love Your Job. Please come on up as we talk about you. Yes.
And joining Mo, please welcome the 2015 Portland Business Journal's Women of Influence Award winner and Senior VP of Branding and Communications at Ferguson Wellman Wealth Management, and our keynote last year, Mary Faulkner.
Amazing to be here, and in particular, it's amazing to be here ready, because last year when I was here, I was like so not ready, although I still didn't change my clothes to look quite as sharp as everybody else to come, but last year I nominated some people, and I was nominated myself, and I really didn't expect to win, and the winner, to talk a little bit about what it meant to me. And that was really an interesting question because my middle son, who's now 21, after I came home with my trophy and I was all excited, he said, well, Mom, what do you get? You get like a tiara or like a trip to Hawaii, you know? And I said, you know, I don't really get anything. And yet it really did mean quite a bit. And what I can tap into is that tonight it means even more. And Shannon, this is all your fault. And also Sarah Poole and all the amazing women and men that are filling the room. And so so what I think it has meant to me is two things in particular that I wanted to share. One is it meant that I felt seen. And as a woman in a largely male-dominated profession, that was important, and it has been important. And the part about that has been particularly important to me is the part that Sarah mentioned when she said that we do it together and that we need to do it together. Because part of feeling seen for me was to run smack dab into the responsibility that I feel like I want to carry for other women, other women out there, which I'll say in a minute about in point two. But the piece that I really want to celebrate tonight are the allies and the supporters that help us, right? And so 2016, when I won this award on stage, was one of the hardest years of my life. And some of you know that because you know me personally. We had a lot of loss and pain and illness and death in my family. And some of that's ongoing, but a lot of it is has healed and moved. And during that time and during other hard times in my life, I've been really aware that what I need to do is get up every day and go to work. I go to work, that's what I do. And my sister, who I admire greatly, who has two disabled children, goes to work every day and she often says to me, thank God for work. And I get what she means. And Sarah talked about hustling and that's important. And so part of what helps me to get up and go to work every day are the women in particular who are my friends and who are there even when it's messy and ragged and dirty and I'm on my knees feeling like I'm not sure if I can get up and go to work. So I thank you to my friends.
Thank
And I would also extend the thank you to my allies. Last year when I won, I spoke about how important men were and how I worry for men today, especially white men in our society. And I am raising two sons. They're mostly grown now, and I'm married to a man who's an incredible support for me, and the father of my children is a huge support, and the allies that I feel in male mentors is powerful. And I thank you for that. And I forgot to mention my daughter on stage last year, and she was completely annoyed at me for that, so for good reason. So what I got into thinking about tonight, and the second thing that this award means to me, is that I'm really passionate right now about what else we need to do for equity for women, and in particular, how do we leverage more equal pay? And So I found a statistic. I was looking at some statistics to get ready, and according to the Women's Policy Research, the Institute for Women's Policy Research, if equal pay for women were instituted immediately across the board, it would result in an annual $447.6 billion gain nationally for women in their families. All full-time year-round workers in the U.S. are paid an average of 77% of what men are paid still. And the disparity is significantly wider for women of color and minorities. And some of you might be familiar. Oh, I can't lose that. You might be familiar with the Count Her In report from the Women's Foundation of Oregon. If you haven't seen it, I highly recommend you go online. They've done some fabulous research, the first comprehensive study of the status of women in our state. And Oregon women earn between 53 and 83 cents, depending on their race and ethnicity, for every dollar men in Oregon earn. And the gender wealth gap of total assets is 35 cents on the dollar. We got some work to do. We got some work to do. And in particular, thank you. In particular, as a white woman, I'm really aware about the significance of the disparity across race. I make more money than women of color that perform, thank you, that perform the same job that I do. So what I wanted to mention tonight, as I end my reign of Woman of the Year, which has felt really nice privately deep down in my heart, to know that I'm seen and that I need to keep working and helping to make a difference in our community with the work that I do, is to think about how can we close the wage gap here in Central Oregon, so that men and women have parity in their wage that helps their families this year and also helps create wealth for women and their families for the future. And in particular, I ask employers in the room to pay attention to your policies and practices around time off, around family leave, and around your disparity of wage across white women and women of color, in addition to looking at the gender difference. So the Women of the Year Award for me has meant a lot personally around feeling seen. It's fortified me when I needed it, and it's helped me remember that I need to bring along other women, white women and women of color, and men that we partner with to help make our community even more vibrant than it already is. It's been truly an honor to have this chamber acknowledgement this year in this community, and I'm so excited to tell you soon who is going to win this year.
On behalf of everyone at Ferguson Wellman and our division, Westbury Investments, I want to start off by thanking Robin Rogers and her team for inviting us back to participate this year. Without a doubt, this is one of our favorite events that we sponsor because it shines a light on women excelling across so many business sectors and so many different nonprofits. My colleague Mark Kroll and I were talking recently about how fortunate we are to work with so many women at Ferguson Wellman. It actually represents five decades. And from that, we benefit so much from wisdom and innovation that we see across all ages and stages, and certainly this event is an example of that as well. We are just so inspired by being involved in this event, and we really think that everyone here in this room is a winner. So congratulations to all of you for such a
Sorry, a little bit of
following Sarah's lead, let me and Adele. So the Woman of the Year Award recognizes women who have excelled in their career, as have so many in the room and in our community, their field of passion, and or have made a significant achievement in a traditionally male-dominated arena.
The essence of the Woman of the Year Award is to discover and reward exceptional women for their leadership. Ladies and gentlemen, I am pleased to introduce our 2015 inaugural Woman of the Year, the accomplished Dr. Becky Johnson.
Well, thank you so much, Mary, and it's really fun to be back here on this stage of the Women of the Year event. Incredible crowd here. Thank you all for being here. And I was incredibly honored to be the inaugural winner of the Women of the Year Award in 2015. And as many people have said tonight, there are so many amazing women in Bend that are doing great things for this community, and just being among the nominees is a great honor. But I have to say that for me, receiving the award was also a validation of sorts. It was a validation for hard work and for trying to do something that I believe is really positive for this community. And in case any of you don't know what I'm talking about, I was building a campus on the west side of Bend. Which not everyone thinks is a great idea. So this award came at a time for me that was very impactful, and I'm very grateful to the chamber and to the people who nominated me for making it possible. So this year, we have another group of incredible nominees for the Women of the Year, and of course, only one woman will win, but I want to congratulate all of the nominees tonight, and you are here because people appreciate, respect, and admire you, and I hope you all walk away feeling like winners. So the nominees, and Mo, why don't you help me read these, and please stand as we go through them. Nita Bells.
Julie Harrelson.
Since 2014, Cascade Angels has invested almost $2 million in 13 Oregon-based early-stage companies, all of which are still in operation and collectively employ over 100 people. Her unique approach to managing Cascade Angels is focused on fueling prosperity. It's about building an economic engine with a connection to Central Oregon, contributing to a sustainable economy, and being a resource for the community. She's truly become a driving force in Central Oregon.
So there's this moment when all that stuff's been read about you and you're sitting there and you're like, oh my God, oh my God. So the Woman of the Year Award this year, I'm so delighted to say, and what a hard choice for the judges on all of these categories, does indeed
go to Julie Harrelson. And I thought to myself, you know, I haven't really had a traditional path to success or to this platform. And I can truly say with certainty that under no circumstances have I ever worn a sash before. Before I launch into the one thing I want to leave you with, I'd also like to thank my lovely wife, Kasuna. My rock and my safe harbor when I'm out, after I'm out doing all these crazy things that I say, how hard can it be? So here's the one thing I'd like to leave you with. A couple weeks ago, I was struggling with something that was pretty difficult, and I noticed that my heart rate was way up. I'm sure you know what that feels like. And actually, it's a bit like that right now. I can feel my heart beating pretty fast. So, what is that one thing? And I think it's that your heart beats for you. Your heart beats for who you love. It beats for the people in your family. It beats for people in your community. It beats for your animals. It beats for your projects. It beats for the world. It beats for your grief. It beats for your sadness. It beats for your anger, and it beats for your fear and your anxiety, and it beats for your joy. So when people say to me, come to me and say, I have an idea I want to do, but I'm really nervous about it, I don't think it's going to work, or I'm worried about it, what I usually say is, well, get your ideas together, get some good advice, figure it out, try it. Because if you follow your interests, good will come of it. So my message to you tonight is follow your heart because it beats for you and good will come of it. The world needs what we each uniquely can bring. And I believe very strongly that if we all work together, things can be different and there can be more love and more creativity and more success in this world for more people. Thank you.
Thank yous and thank yous.
sponsors, I want to make sure that I highlight something incredibly important that it cannot go without being noticed. I met a particular lady about an hour before walking on stage, and she rushed over from Salem today to be here for this event, and she actually turned down her nomination for the Women of the Year Award because she had other obligations. And she's the Deschutes County Commissioner. She's also my wonderful co-host, Tammy Bain.
Thank you. Tonight's event was incredible, and when I was asked to MC and be co-MC with you, I just feel so blessed to live in this community. I mean, Julie, you mentioned about the heartbeat, it beats in our community. Each and every one of you gives something special. And I may be biased, I was raised here, but I look around this room of individuals that I've worked with for decades, and individuals that I've met just today. And I feel so fortunate that I hope each and every one of you know how cool it is to live in Bend. But there's a commitment there, and there's a dedication to this community as well that I hope each and every one of you take home tonight. So we also would like to thank all the nominees. We would like to thank all of the judges. Miss Katie, we'd like to call you back. Oh, there you are. All right. We're going to thank our sponsors. But I also wanted to say tonight we learned about culture, and we learned about heritage. And I wanted to thank Rose Miller for her dancing since she was 5 years old, and the Ohana dancers of Hawaii. And then the little guy was laying down. I feel like that'll be me later.
Yeah.
I know, exactly.
Take these shoes off, I'm on the ground.
Yes, yeah. And the power of word with Ellen. Thank you for sharing. Thank you. Sarah, oh my gosh, inspiration. And that, you know, hustle and dedication and get up early and beat them to it. Be dedicated in your community. But most of all, we learned that we in this community offer grace and love and support. And I love that Mo mentioned that when she was really challenged and she was at a place where she was kind of sad and down, she was given this award and she was held in this space of love by this community. So thank you for all that you do. And we'd like to thank our sponsors and thank each of you for being here this evening.
And I'd like to thank you on behalf of the Bend Chamber for being with us in this space tonight and allowing us to honor all of you for not only the nominees and the winners, but everyone here who cares about them. Thank you for coming. I have a couple of things to share with you. First of all, there are three jars in the backstage. Well, it's to my right, to your left, outside the door. There are little glass beads, and there are three jars, one with an emoji that's sad, one with an emoji that is indifferent and unmoved by this evening, and then another emoji who's really happy. We just would like your feedback on what you thought of tonight's events. For every bead you put in one of those jars, the Bend Chamber is going to donate $1 to the scholarship fund. So, yes. So please put your bead in there, and let's give our scholarship winner a little bit more money to send her on her way. So I'm going to end with inviting everyone who is a nominee and a winner and the judges to please join me up on stage. We're going to take a few photos. The rest of you are released to go out and support the next Woman of the Year for 2018. Thank you for coming.